in the book of Ezekiel, the second chapter, verse number 5, and in the F section of that verse number 5, it states, "Yet they shall know there has been a prophet among them." And I want to talk to you today briefly from the subject, the reasons why I preach, or the reasons why we preach. As we gather to honor this preacher on the 30th anniversary of his call to ministry, we realize in honoring him, we also honor ourselves. This is indeed a wonderful moment, a wonderful occasion. And I want to congratulate this church, the committee, and all who helped sponsor this celebration. Words are not adequate to express our appreciation to God, who in his wisdom saw fit to call our brother and friend to this holy and challenging ministry. We also give thanks and salutations to his beloved wife, Yvette, who has given so much to encourage and support Reverend Whittaker in ministry.
Amen. Amen.
No wonder the Bible states that if a man finds a wife, he finds something good. We also salute his children. They too give so much in ministry, and we praise God for them. In our time together, I want to call to your attention the life of a man who was both a prophet and a priest. The setting of this text, the captives had been in Babylon 5 years, and there was not a true prophet to be found. I mean, can you imagine what it would be like to be in a city where there was no preacher? For 5 years, there was no preacher in that area. It was a disturbing time for the people of God. They had known all kinds of experiences. There was a revolutionary experience. There were all kinds of things going on. It was as a storm cloud began to sweep down across the plains toward Ezekiel. From the north, the heavens were open, and the Bible says he saw visions of God. It was in connection with this natural phenomenon, a frightening storm cloud, that Ezekiel was to have a strange spiritual experience. This vision of God was to impress vividly upon his mind both the transcendence of God and also the accessibility of God. The great God whom he and the other exiles had worshipped in Jerusalem had come into the land of exiles with him. This transcendent God was calling him to be to a prophetic ministry. He was to be God's spokesman to the exiles. As I studied this passage from Ezekiel, I began to see here reasons why Ezekiel preached under frustrating circumstances, and why even now preachers continue to do the same. And I want to say to you, preaching the word, pastoring a congregation is not easy. Because you have to pastor as many members you have, and that's a difficult job. Everybody's different. I would like to share some of these reasons with you that have been impressed upon my mind, the reasons why we preach. Now, the first reason I feel we preach is because of what God has done for us. You see, if God hasn't done anything for us, then we have no basis for preaching. Without a personal experience with God, then trying to preach would be like trying to feed the hungry out of an empty basket. We preach because we are grateful for what God has done for us. You know, if God hasn't done anything for us, then our message becomes hollow. And you show me a preacher who's been perfect all his life, never done anything wrong, that God hasn't had to bring him through something. And that preacher is not able to empathize with the people. But if he too has been our chosen, and God rescued him, God turned him around, God gave him a new song to sing, and when he stands before the people and tells them it doesn't matter what you're going through, God is able to bring you out. That's power, isn't it? Not what somebody tells me, but I tell you what I know. That one day I was lost on my way to hell, but God wouldn't let me go. Said, I still have work for you. And so we preach because of what God has done for us. Not only that, but one day we could have been sick. I've heard many preachers say that they were on the verge of death. And they said to God, God, I know you called me into this ministry, but if you raise me up, I'll be obedient. God raised them up, and they have to run and tell somebody. You see, when you tell what God has done for you, what a difference it makes. You know, any preacher who only preaches from the book could be in trouble, but folk can read the book for themselves. But preaching becomes powerful when we combine it with our own life experiences. That when we can say to the world, I know what I believe. I know where God brought me from. I know what God has brought me through because one day he did it. And I made a commitment to him. You see, when you preach because of what God has done for you, it's not easy to become discouraged because you know it's all about what God has done. And when I listen to preachers preach, I look for that personal experience. I want to know, have you had an encounter with God?
Yes.
Second reason we preach, and this is most important, we preach because that is what God has called us to do. You see, in our church, we still believe that God calls. No, Grandma didn't call. Mama didn't call, preacher didn't call, but God called. And I contend every preacher ought to have a sense of that God has called. And therefore, we don't preach because we want to. God knows we preach because we have to. I tell preachers all the time, if you can put it up and take it down, then you ought to leave it down. I mean, but if you preach because God has called you to preach, it's like fire shot up in your bones. And if you preach because God has called you to preach, nobody can keep you from preaching. And even if the people won't hear you, you go out under a shade tree and tell those who come by, God is still on the throne. Because God has called us.
Yes, yes.
Sense of calling. You know, God's calling makes the difference.
Yes.
You know, I say to preachers coming into the conference, I need to know about your calling.
Yes.
I mean, what is it that led you here? Why didn't you do something else? And if you can do something else, then go on and do it. But if you preach because you feel a sense that God has called you in, then come on. Because you know it's not going to be easy out there. And you ask Reverend Whittaker some of his experiences over the last 30 years, they haven't been easy. Because when you preach, you're going to make some folk mad sometimes. Oh, you all don't hear me. And when you preach, you're going to step on somebody's soul sometimes. That is, not everybody's going to like you, but if you make people like you important to you, you're in trouble.
Yeah.
And folks are not going to like you for one reason or another, but the thing that drives us in preaching, not because people like us, but because they respect us, because they love God, because it is God who is in control, it is God who guides our lives, and even our ministry. We preach because God has called us.
Yeah.
And you know, wherever God leads, I've learned he also provides. Do I have a witness?
Yeah.
I said, wherever God leads, he also provides. That if God is in it, it's going to work out. If God is in it, he'll make a way. He'll raise up a nation that will obey if God is in it.
Yes, yes, yes.
And so we have to make sure God is in it. Because you know, in this text, God said to Ezekiel, I'm sending you to the Israelites. And all of that, he told him what he wanted him to say. And so, you know, when we preach, we don't tell folk what we want them to know. We have to tell them what thus said the Lord.
Amen.
When people get angry, let them get angry with God.
Yes.
Because we tell them what God has told us to tell them. Now finally, you see, God sent Ezekiel into a tough spot. And he sends every preacher into a tough spot. He told Ezekiel, I'm sending you to a rebellious people. You know what a rebellious folk know? Oh, you all don't hear me. I'm glad I can preach this here because everybody is in love with each other. There's no rebellion here. But God told Ezekiel a part of the bargain. I'm sending you to a rebellious people. God called him, God sent him. You see, the thing that we have to remember, the fact that there is a rebellious streak in all of us.
Yes.
You know, people don't have to be taught to be rebellious. That streak is in us. It's born in us. I remember when my son was just a few months old, maybe very young, and I saw that rebellious streak. My wife had developed a routine with him. Every night, she'd give him his bath. She would rub him down. She would give him his bottle. He'd get in the rocking chair, and next thing you know, he was gone. Just a little guy. One night, she went through the routine, gave him his bath, rubbed him down, gave him his bottle, and as she was beginning to rock him, he stretched out. would cooperate. How did he know to do that? That streak is there, isn't it? That streak is in all of us. That rebellious streak we are born with. Well, what I've learned about God is the fact that though we have that rebellious streak in us, God is able to tame that spirit. Do I have a witness? God is able to tame us. Rather than being rebellious, he makes us cooperate. And when we realize it's not about us, it's about him. You see, people become rebellious when they can't have their own way. Oh, you all don't hear me. I said people become rebellious when they're used to having their own way. And when they can't have their own way, that becomes a problem. But you know, when you get wrapped up in God, truly saved from a miserable life of sin, you realize it's not about you, it's about God. It's not about what you want, it's about what God wants. And when we come to church, we come surrendered to God, that God might feed us with the bread of heaven, that God might open our blinded eyes, that God will open our stuffed up ears, that God will rescue us if we're headed in the wrong direction. God will show us that there is a better way, that there is a way out of whatever we're going through, that we don't have to be rebellious. We can take it to the Lord in prayer. Rebellious people. But what I like about it, he didn't run from that. What did he do? He preached to them. And I say to preachers everywhere, we've got to preach. Preaching will do what nothing else can do. We don't have to fuss with folk. We don't have to fight with folk. All we have to do is do what God told us. Tell the old story. Do I have a witness? I said, tell the old story. People need to hear the old story. Because the old story will make a difference. You see, preaching is so important. Preaching opens spiritual blinded eyes. Preaching will set captives free. And other preaching, oh, how it makes. Now I'm talking about real preaching. I'm not talking about the three points and a poem. I'm talking about that preaching that gets down to the nitty-gritty. That preaching that says to the world, this is not what I say, but this is come from the word of God. Not my opinion, but it's what God would have us to know. How we need to hear some good news. Preaching is good news. Now, people already know how bad they are. They already know how bad the world is. They want to know, is there a way out of this mess? Do I have a witness? I mean, they know that they've messed up. They know that they've gone astray. They want to know, is there any way out? I was way down yonder by myself. Couldn't hear nobody pray. I was in need and wondering, am I destined to this forever? But the preacher is able to say, no, it doesn't matter where you are. God is able to pick you up. God is able to turn you around. God is able to give you a new song to sing. Put joy in your heart. Put running in your feet. He's able to close doors. Hinder you, he's able to open doors that nobody can close.
Yes.
Preaching. And what I believe the best thing we can do for preachers today is to have patience. Not only with the preacher, but with preaching. I mean, we're in sad shape in the church today. We have people who worship singing and want the preacher to preach as quick as he can. I want you all to hear me. We will go to the ends of the city for singing. But preaching, we start looking at our clock and our watch. And I remember when we moved into the new Trinity Church, we don't have a clock there. And somebody wanted to donate a very nice clock to the church. And I said, well, you tell me the theology of the clock. What does it mean? Well, you see, put the clock there, I'm still going to preach the same amount of time. That money could be better spent. Because I believe when we come in church, we ought to lose sight of something. When we come in church, we ought not be so wrapped up into what time it is. When we come to church, we ought to be serious about we're coming into the presence of God. That this is the house of God. And in God's house, I lose sight of myself. I lose sight of time.
He said, I see that you and your husband don't have a child.
God's going to give you a child.
Hallelujah.
She blessed the preacher. God blessed her. Oh, you don't hear me? See, the old folk had that thing right. They were willing to bless the preacher. I remember a church I used to serve where the old folk wanted to make sure that the preacher came to their house once a year for a meal. Now, it wasn't because we didn't have no food at home, but they wanted the preacher's presence in their home. Do we still long for that? That we want the preacher's prayers in our home. It's all right for the preacher to pray in the church, but every now and then, we ought to have the preacher to come to our homes, to bless our homes, to pray God's blessing over our family, that our family might be what God would have them to be. Bless the person of God, and if you bless the person of God, God will bless you. But oh, if you fight God's purpose. Oh, y'all don't look at me too strange. This is still preaching. Oh, yes, it is. You get in trouble with God, for God has said, touch not my anointing. What I've learned, if the preacher is wrong, you can't straighten him out. If the preacher is wrong, God will take care of the preacher. Oh, yes, he will. God will take care of the preacher. But if you try to take care of the preacher, you get in trouble with God. I don't know about you, but I don't want to get in trouble with God. I don't want to be in such a way that God can bless me. I want to bless preachers that God truly might be blessed. Let us celebrate preaching. Let us celebrate with this preacher that the next 30 years will be as fruitful as the past 30 years.
Thank you.
That God will bless him in days to come. That he will continue to grow and be the preacher God is calling him to be. You know, we in our church have got to get back to making preachers. Oh, yes, God calls them, but the church has to make them. Y'all got quiet on that. But I want you to think about it. Think about it. We've got to get back to making preachers. We got to stop having roast preachers for dinner on Sunday. Go back to making preachers. Oh, how the world needs good preachers. Preachers who have been with God, who have a sense of calling. Eternal God, we thank you for this moment. We thank you for this time of celebration. And we pray that you will bless. Bless Contee Church as they celebrate 30 years in this preacher's life. Grant that this celebration will be a turning point for the preacher and the church. They will not look into the past. Be prepared.